ओम ज्ञान तिमिरंधस्य ज्ञानांजन शलाकाय चक्षुरुन्मिलितं येन तस्मै श्री गुरवे नमः नमः ओम विष्णुपादाय कृष्ण प्रेष्ठाय भूतले श्रीमते भक्ति वेदांत स्वामी इति नामिने नमस्ते सारस्वती देवे गौरवाणी प्रचारिणे निर्विशेष शून्यवादी पाश्चात्य देश तारिणे वांचा कल्पतरुभ्यश्च कृपा सिंधुभ्य एव च पतितानां पावनेभ्यो वैष्णवेभ्यो नमो नमः जय श्री कृष्ण चैतन्य प्रभु नित्यानंद श्री अद्वैत गदाधार श्रीवासादि गौर भक्तवृंद हरे कृष्णा 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 हरे 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 राम 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 हरे 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 कृष्णा थैंक यू वेरी मच फॉर कमिंग टुडे इफ एनी ऑफ यू वांट टू सिट अबव इट्स परफेक्टली फाइन यू कैन सिट हियर आल्सो वेरी इट्स कंफर्टेबल यू आल्सो इफ यू कंफर्टेबल ओके थैंक यू सो द टॉपिक आई वाज ट्राइंग टू स्पीक ऑन टुडे इज बियॉन्ड द माइंड टू द हार्ट प्रैक्टिसिंग भक्ति विथ आवर माइंड एंड विदाउट इट ऑल्सो So what do I mean by this? From the mind to the heart. So broadly speaking, if we consider how our nature of our existence, if I say this is the world, then here there is the mind and here there is the soul. So am I audible to everyone? Yes, fine. Oh, fine. So now, and this is visible also, or it's too small? Visible? Okay. So now the concept of the heart, where it exactly is something which is a bit mysterious. So, okay, thank you. So basically, what I mean by this is, generally when we use the word heart, we are not using it in a literal sense. It's not obviously not referring to the biological organ. Say you broke my heart. Well, I do X-ray. I still say the heart is as it is. So we are referring to the heart as the seat of emotions. Now, at one level, we could say our emotions, the faculty within us, which is associated with emotions, is the mind. Because we could say that the mind is associated with emotions. And the intelligence is associated with reason. So, emotion, reason, broadly we could say like that. But then emotion is not just associated with the mind. It is also associated with the soul. Because ultimately, emotion comes when there is consciousness. And when there is consciousness, the consciousness experiences everything including emotions. So, with this frame, so we could say, now where is the heart? There is a verse in Chaitanya Charan, where Chaitanya Mahaprabhu says, Mora Man Vrindavan. Says, it is my mind which is Vrindavan. But then Prabhupada translates Mana as heart over there. Says, my heart is Vrindavan. So, are the mind and the heart the same thing? So, to understand this, more important than the terms is the concept. See, our inner world is multi-level and we could have say some surface desires, emotions, and we could have some deep desires, emotions. So now if you consider these two, broadly speaking, surface emotions are say we are just walking along the road and we see something attractive, maybe some good food to eat, maybe a new gadget to buy, maybe something attractive, I just want to shop it. Now, in that case, if we had not seen it, we would not have got that desire. Now, again, here I don't want to split hair too much, but what is the difference between the desire and emotion? Desire is more an active engagement or force which causes engagement with the outer reality. And a desire means I want to go out and do something. I want to get it. I want to enjoy it. I want to experience it. Mm. Whereas emotion, so desire is more like an outward flow from our consciousness to do something. So from our consciousness to the external reality, to the circumstance. Whereas emotion is more a inward flow from the circumstance to the consciousness. Emotion is what we experience in particular situations by certain perceptions. Now, in a sense, emotion and desire are not entirely unrelated. We could say emotions can create desires. Now, if I see somebody crying, a small child crying alone on the street, then I feel an emotion of concern, of sadness, of agony, and then the greatest desire, I want to help this child. So they are not entirely unrelated, but for the purpose of analysis, we could say that emotion is more a result of an outward flow into our consciousness. So when someone says something, I feel angry. That's an emotion. And when I'm angry, I get the desire to beat that person, physically or maybe verbally, whatever. So desire and emotion are like that. But now these also can be at a surface level or they can be a deeper level. Surface means just some circumstance, something comes up and it triggers something within me. But some things may be very deeply felt by us. That means that we all have, we could say, various levels of desires. Yeah, I want to read the newspaper. That's one desire. But I want to read Bhagavatam. That's also another desire. So I like sports, but I like Shastra also. Now we could say intellectually we understand Shastra is more important than sports. It's fine, but also we may say that studying Shastra is like a deep aspiration for us. As reading about sports, okay, that's something which I just like to do, I'll do it. So in that sense, we could say, if we say that broadly speaking, the seat of emotions is the heart. So when we use the broke my heart, that means the seat of emotions where we had, the emotions were disrupted, wounded. So then the heart can refer to both the mind and the soul. It depends on this same thing, I am inverting it like this. So here we see it as a horizontal, but if we make it vertical, so we could say the emotions which are related with the mind are at the surface. The emotions which are related to the soul are at a deep level. And now for us, the love for Krishna is situated at a very deep level. It is there. Now when I am traveling, I often misplace and lose things. So when I lose something, one way I console myself is by saying, I didn't lose it because I was so careless. I lost it because I was so careful that I kept it in such a place that I can't remember it, and now I lost it. So, sometimes you keep it so carefully. Why did I keep it? I don't remember now. So, for us, some of our deep desires, they are very deep, but they get lost deep inside us. Not because we don't care for them, but we make them like so important that we feel everything else has to be carefully done, then I'll do this. Like somebody says, okay, I want to chant, but I will chant only when I can concentrate perfectly. Hell, then you'll never be able to chant. Then we'll never be able to chant because our mind, when will we be able to concentrate? So, there'll always be something which will agitate us. So we could say that there are different levels of emotions within us. So when I'm talking about beyond the mind to the heart, what I'm meaning is beyond the surface emotions that we have to the deeper emotions that we have. So how do we get to that deepest level of our consciousness? So that which is really important for us, how do we get to that in our life? And for this, broadly, I said the other part of the title was how to practice bhakti with our mind and without our mind. With our mind means that the surface emotions cooperate in our inward journey. And without our mind means the surface emotions don't cooperate, but still we persevere. So, what do I mean by the surface emotions? Now, the word surface might convey that it is superficial, but although they are superficial, they can be very strong. Mm-hmm. So, broadly speaking, the emotions within us, we can put them in three categories. Mm-hmm. One is those which are related to the soul, spiritual. The other is which is related with our swabhava, and the third is those which are related with our anarthas. So that means that our anarthas means our lust, anger, greed, envy, pride, all of these trigger certain emotions within us. And then now we could say both of these, the related with the swabhava is also material. It could be somebody is a brahmana, somebody is kshatriya. So somebody is a brahmana, they just naturally feel delighted whenever they get some new book to read, some new intellectual concept to digest. Somebody who is a vaishya, now they may not be necessarily greedy, but just as soon as that subject becomes about money, they perk up. Even when serving Krishna, if it is all about philosophy, okay, it's about fundraising. Oh, let's do something now. We are going to do something now. So, we could say our emotions can be related with our swabhava, and ultimately they are related about our soul, with the soul, which is Krishna. So, when we say we practice bhakti with our mind means we go along with our swabhava, and without our mind means we don't go along with the anarthas. So, we want to reach the soul, and then we want to bring out the soul's potential for serving Krishna, for loving Krishna. So within our, now both of these, where are they situated? The anarthas and swabhava, both are situated in the mind. Both are there in the mind, and we need to deal with both of them appropriately. So, we could say over here, say if the soul is over, okay, let me put it this way. If I consider surface desires, say if these are the anarthas, then you say this, at this level there are anarthas and here there is swabhava. So now if the anarthas are forming a current, now that current may not take us toward the soul, that current may take me away from the soul toward the world, and I neglect that current. So we could envision this as if somebody is rowing a boat. Then if somebody has to go a long distance in a boat, it's important for them to catch the right current. Otherwise they will be rowing against the current constantly, and it can be very exhausting. So now if somebody tries to row against the current of their swabhava, it's a lifelong struggle and they'll soon give up. It can't be done. But we all need to row against the current of our anarthas. Thus, when we simply say that actually this is, you are just all being, just give up everything material, surrender to Krishna. Well, it's not that simple. Everything material can't be given up. Certain material things which are unfavorable, they need to be given up. So it's like our consciousness is always flow along a particular current, a particular channel. We can't stop that. That means there are already, say, paths created in our consciousness, and the consciousness will flow along those channels. If we say none of these channels, it's not going to work. But some of these channels, okay, no. Say somebody is very lusty, very greedy, very angry, and consciousness actually flows in that direction. You have to create some regulation. No, not, I will not let it go in this direction. But we all have a particular swabhava, and the consciousness will flow along that direction. If we try to stop that, we will feel completely repressed. We will feel as if I just can't do anything. So in the Bhagavad-Gita, when Krishna says, Nigraha kim karishyasi, what will repression accomplish? He's talking about your consciousness will flow along a particular channel. Arjuna, you are a kshatriya. Your consciousness will flow along the kshatriya channel. You cannot stop that. So, when we want to practice bhakti, we want to make sure that the anartha channel, that we stop it. But the swabhava channel, we activate it. Now, sometimes the anartha and sabhava channel, they also get overlapped. Say, for example, somebody is doing some service and say, so each service requires some facility, some position, some resources. Now, if a speaker is giving a class and a speaker is very concerned how many people are there for the class. Now, at one level, it could just be genuine concern because I am sharing some wisdom and it's Krishna's wisdom. I want more and more people to come. But it also could be pride. I want more people to come for my class than for somebody else's class. So, sometimes a Kshatriya wants to, Kshatriya actually has a desire to rule and to control and to delegate and to get things done. Now, one can do that for Krishna also. But while doing that, one gets certain position, certain authority. So things when we try to go into the details, always there is, they say the devil resides in the details. So we could say that what particular emotion is coming from anartha and what is coming from a swabhava, that can sometimes get fuzzy. But broadly, if you understand this category, generally, we need first the categorization of black and white. And then we can look at shades of grey. If we start only with shades of grey, then we will never be able to distinguish anything. So, these things are not as simple as what this frame might say. Okay, the material emotions associated with anartha say no, and the material emotions are the emotions associated with the swabhava say yes. But at least this broad categorization of black and white, if you understand, then we can move forward. Now, I'll keep this talk brief, and I would like to hear from you also, and then we can have more question answer discussion. I'll make one more point, and then I'll conclude with how bhakti applies within the situation. Say, as I said, there is some fuzzy zone between what is a anartha and what is a swabhava. The very word anartha has a negative connotation to it. It is something which is unwanted, and the very word swabhava has a positive connotation. That's what your nature is. But if we consider some people, for example, are more sentimental than rational, and some people are more rational than sentimental. Now, if somebody is very, very emotional, I don't think this is erasable, isn't it? Do we have another box, another sheet? Okay, I'll do it over here, no problem. See, so I'll show a particular, that's okay, Mataji, I don't need much. It's a particular framework. Okay, okay, that's fine. Let me complete this. If I need, I'll do it further. So, we could say, emotion and dedication. And if I do, now this, I'll do this for emotion, we can do this for dedication also. What's going on? No, it should be okay, just dedication over here. So basically what I'm saying is, you could have four categories of people. There is no emotion, no dedication. There is, yes. There is no emotion, no dedication. There is no emotion, but there is dedication. There is emotion and there is dedication. There is emotion and there is no dedication. Maybe this diagram has made it a little confusing, but I think the four categories are clear for you. So basically, some people, they are very emotional, and any small thing happens, they get so excited. It's like they see a new devotee, some devotee or something, they go and give a big hug. And you ask them, after how many months are you meeting them? After 2 hours. Really? After 2 hours? So some devotees are very emotional. And say somebody who is very rational, they say, why so emotional? Some devotees may just cry when they see the deity, they see the spiritual master. And somebody says, why are you being so sentimental? But the important thing is that some people might just have a more emotional nature. So emotionality is something which we may not be able to change so much. But the key thing is not how much emotion is present or absent, but the key thing is how much dedication is present. So if you consider these four categories, there is no emotion and no dedication. That will be people who are non-devotees, materialists. If there is emotion but no dedication, those are the people who are, we could say, sentimentalists, sahajiyas. Then we could have dedication but no emotion. So we could say that is devotees who are rational, but not so, they're rational, but they're not so emotional. And we could have devotees with emotion and dedication. So they are emotional and dedicated. Is this, I'll repeat this once again, is it clear? So no emotion, no dedication is a materialistic person. There's only emotion, no dedication. That is a sentimental, that is sahajiya. But then we could have no emotion and dedication, and we could have emotion and dedication. And this will depend on how a person's basic nature is. So some people may work very hard to decorate the deities and so make sure that the Janmashtami festival, Abhishek and everything goes on well. But you know, they may just be grave throughout. And some people, when the darshan opens, the tears start coming from their eyes and they become so overwhelmed by that. Now, it could be that the second person is more advanced, but it need not be. So when we say that we practice bhakti with our mind and without our mind. So here, if I use the word mind to refer to our emotional side, then some people who are by nature emotional, they may get a lot of emotions when they are practicing bhakti. And that's good, getting that emotion. They use that as long as they are dedicated, that is the important thing. They are committed to practicing bhakti, committed to serving Krishna, then they are moving on in their lives. In contrast, if they are not able to, if they are not having exhibiting any emotions, but again they are dedicated, then also that is fine. So, with now this emotion, if somebody is exhibiting some emotion in relationship with Krishna, now is it coming from the soul? Maybe not. Normally you talk about Swabhava as Brahman, Kshatriya, Vaishya, Shudra, but you could also refer to Swabhava as, say, this particular classification of emotional and rational. That is quite, to some extent, very deeply inbuilt. So, okay, that's your, you go along with your Swabhava, emotion or reason, and just practice bhakti. Now, can emotionality be an anartha? If emotion becomes a substitute for dedication, not only there is emotion without dedication, but emotion is a substitute for dedication. That means I have such emotions. Why are you expecting me to do sadhana? Why are you expecting me to do this? I already have the bhava. When it becomes like that, then it can be an anartha. It is emotion without dedication need not be necessarily a deceptive kind of person. It might just be just casual. Sometimes they, but if they consider that emotion alone is enough and I don't need dedication at all, then they will stagnate over there. They will never move forward. In fact, then it becomes a serious problem. So those people are imitators. They pretend that they are advanced devotees when they actually don't make much advancement. So when we talk about moving forward in our spiritual life, so we may have a particular way of functioning, and that is perfectly fine. We can't change that. So emotionality, it need not be an anartha. It can be just a part of our swabhava, and we accept that, but we don't try to repress that, but we use that and move on. Now there is a problem with everything. So people who are emotional, or their emotional side is more active, they can also get more easily emotionally wounded. Emotionally wounded. They can get emotionally wounded very easily. And they will feel those emotional wounds much more deeply than a person who is rational. So, if somebody speaks something hurtful to us, now everybody will feel hurt by that, but somebody who is more rational, they will be able to process it. Yeah, the world is like this, people are like that, or maybe they were in a bad mood or whatever. They will be able to more or less intellectually process it and move on. It will hurt, but it won't be that much. So, whereas somebody who is more emotional, for them to process it may not be that easy. They may feel much more deeply hurt. It's like, you know, with respect to shaving, when we shave, sometimes we cut, you know, when we cut the skin. Now, I've seen different people, when they cut their skin, for some people a lot of blood comes out. There's one devotee in the Pune Brahmachari Ashram, whenever he would cut, like it appear as if it like his whole face gets filled with blood because of small wound. And you say, hey, what's happened? It looks, but some other people, it's like they have a big scar of a cut, but no blood has come out. So what happens is, just as different people may bleed differently, the wounds may pain differently. That what applies at the physical level also applies at a mental level. And so, when there are emotional wounds, different people may need different approaches for dealing with their emotional wounds. Some people are more rational, even the emotional wounds of say somebody neglecting them, somebody betraying them, somebody abusing them, whatever. Those they will process more through the intellectual means. For them, maybe understanding the philosophy, reading something else, that might help them more. For somebody who is more emotional, they may need more human empathy. They may need somebody to just sit down and hear. And they pour out their heart. And they may need to be healed. Even in say psychotherapy, there are different approaches. There are some approaches which are, say for example, in cognitive behavioral therapy, it's more of using the rational faculty to analyze what went wrong and to deal with it. There are some other, there is say for example, acceptance commitment therapy. There's another form of therapy within mindfulness, which focuses more on, okay, don't try to analyze it, accept it. This is the way the world is, and accept it and move on. And these different approaches work. One approach works for more for some kind of people. Another approach works for another kind of people. So the point is that when we have to, sometimes we can go with our mind. Sometimes we have to go toward Krishna without our mind. But rather than thinking that there has to be one way, this worked for me, this should also work for you. See, I read the Bhagavatam and suppose we lose a loved one or something, and then just read the Chitraketu pastime. Some people might read it and they feel very good about it, okay. But somebody else may not. They may process grief in a different way. So, if some devotees, for example, when they have some loss or some emotional pain, sometimes they may feel the need to go to some healer, therapist, and others may just chant Hare Krishna, just study the Shastra, it will all be fine. So, here the important thing is not exactly what method works. Or what method is adopted, but what method works? What method works? Because my mind is different from your mind. And if I understand that, then I may, so somebody has hurt me and my mind is also wounded by that. But because I am not that emotional, I can say that I can just put aside my mind, and without my mind I can go toward Krishna. Without my mind means without caring much for emotions, I can neglect that part and move on. But for somebody that is very emotional, they just can't do that. That emotional wound becomes like such a blockage, they just can't move forward in their consciousness. And they have to deal with that. So for them to go, they cannot go without their mind, they have to go with their mind. That means they have to deal with that emotion, they have to remove that blockage. And then they move forward toward Krishna. So when we are practicing bhakti, each one of us has to have this individual application of bhakti, where there are certain universal principles or even certain universal, there is a universal purpose that we are pursuing, but we all need to have we customize our practice of bhakti so that we can move beyond the mind to the heart, so that gradually our spiritual connection with Krishna can become activated and then can become the center of our life. So I'll summarize. I spoke on this theme of how we can move from the mind to the heart in our practice of bhakti. So basically I started by talking about how the mind and the soul, they can both combined be referred to the heart, in the sense that the heart is the seat of emotions, and sometimes our emotions come from the mind, sometimes they come from the soul. So I talked about multiple levels of emotions within us. Desire is what outward flow of our consciousness toward the world. Emotion is a response to the inward flow of consciousness from the world. So when we talk about these, we all have at a surface level some emotions. We need to go beyond them to the deeper level. Now then we discuss that at the surface level there can be two. There can be anarthas and there can be the swabhava. So the anarthas, we go without our mind. That means when the mind gets agitated with, say, lust or anger or greed or envy, we go without it. That is where the approach of neglect the mind and move on, do your bhakti, that will work. But when it's a swabhava, then we cannot neglect. Then nigraha kim karishis, what will repression accomplish? Then we need to go along with that toward Krishna. So those emotions related to swabhava are deeper. Now what is swabhava and what is anartha? There can be sometimes shades of grey for that. But first we need to broadly understand the black and white, then we can look at the grey. Then one something within the grey, for that I look at the emotion aspect. So some people are more emotional than rational. And what will be their spiritual journey? So we talk about these four categories. No emotion, no dedication, which is just people who are non-spiritualist entirely. Then emotion but no dedication, they are the sentimentalists. Then emotion and dedication or no emotion and dedication. So emotion and dedication, we could say they are emotional devotees, emotional but dedicated devotees, serious devotees. And there are serious and dedication, no emotion and dedication, we could say they are more rational but dedicated devotees. So now both can be dedicated, but both will respond to life situations differently. Say when somebody is emotionally wounded, the rational devotee will not sustain so much wounds, or they will not hurt them so much, and they might just process it intellectually and move on. But those emotional, they will need to process it in a different way. They may need emotional healing till before their consciousness can move toward Krishna. So by understanding, by observing ourselves and understanding ourselves, we can customize our bhakti practices so that we ensure that our consciousness moves towards Krishna, and gradually our spiritual emotions become activated and they become the center of our consciousness and our heart. Thank you very much. Hare Krishna.
Hare.
So any questions or comments? Yes, please.
I mean, you were distinguishing between the surface emotions or surface desires and emotions. I understood the surface desires, you know, when the external stimuli, acts like a callus for your desires. But when you were saying that the emotions are the inward flow from
I'll explain that once again. What is the difference between emotions and desires in terms of inward and outward flow? Okay, so basically our consciousness, when we experience something within our consciousness, there are three broad aspects. We perceive something, then we process that thing, and then we pursue something. So perceive, process and pursue. Now perception is what happens through the senses. That is when consciousness comes, or rather stimuli flows outward into our consciousness. Stimuli are flowing into the consciousness from outside. So that's when perception has happened. Now at the level of processing, that is where we experience emotion. Normally, you could use the word processing in intellectual terms, like information processing or whatever. But you can, there can be emotional processing also. But when we process, that is when we experience emotions. So we could say the perception has flown in the stimuli. Okay, now to confuse this further, the word consciousness also, we use it to refer to two different things. We refer to consciousness as a territory sometimes, you know, guard your consciousness. And consciousness, we also refer to it as the energy that flows from the territory. Energy that flows from the territory. Say for example, my consciousness is caught in that thing right now. My consciousness is caught in, somebody's consciousness is caught in sports, somebody's consciousness is caught in movies or whatever. So that means, so if we consider the example of this light source, the light source and the light, so the bulb and the light. So consciousness can refer to the bulb and consciousness can refer to the light also. Of course, the difference is that light only flows outwards, but consciousness also, there's inward flow also in it. Consciousness flows inward means when we see something, then the information comes inwards.
I think that's why I got a little confused.
Okay.
I don't normally think of consciousness flowing inward.
Okay, by consciousness, what I'm referring to is that when our consciousness flows outward, we perceive something.
Yes.
It's like say there's a radar or so, some there are some rays that go outwards. And when the rays hit something, then they are reflected back. So that, so our consciousness also refers to, if I see something, there's a reflection backward.
Okay.
And then that enters back into us, isn't it?
Okay.
So if I see a gulab jamun, my consciousness is looking around everywhere. I say, oh, that's nice.
Locks in on
it. So it locks in on it and then you process it more. So you could say there's perception. Let's forget about that consciousness flowing inward right now. It's a little, I don't need to complicate that. But there is perceive and there is process. So at the level of processing, we experience emotions. I like it, I don't like it. That's terrible, that's interesting, that's delicious. And then, based on the emotion that we are experiencing, a certain desire arises. So desire is where the consciousness is impelling us to do some action. So in that sense, when the information about the stimuli flows inward into our consciousness and the result of that inward flow is emotion, whereas when the consciousness flows outward after we experience some emotion, that outward flow is the expression of a desire. That is a desire. So I see a gulab jamun, hey, that's nice, that's the expression of emotion. I want to eat it, that's a desire.
Okay.
So any and I'm open to comments also when I say it's not just questions. If some of something spoke to you, something didn't make sense to you, you can please speak that also. Yes.
I'm trying to articulate this. Sometimes people are traumatized by a life experience.
Yeah.
And then person who hasn't been traumatized can't understand why they are stuck, you know, in this way of responding to a situation, right? And they say, just get over it, you know, that happened in the past, just go get over it. So sometimes I think about the just get over it means strengthen your will, and through your will, you can succeed in putting aside the impressions that were formed. And that seems to be saying that you're more of a spiritual agent than a mechanism that is shaped by experience. But sometimes it seems like something's lacking. Maybe the will can't overcome the mechanistic disturbance of the trauma. I don't know if I'm being clear. In my process of thinking about this, I thought, if you look at the trauma and say it's determining how I behave, that's being in the bodily conception of life. Like, but if you realize I'm a spiritual agent, so if I apply my agency or I call for help, and the help comes, I can transcend the mechanistic response that's been shaped by it.
Beautiful, yeah. So some people, they're traumatized, but they just don't seem to be able to get over it. It seems that their willpower doesn't move beyond the mechanical impact of the trauma. But if they see themselves as spiritual agents, then they will be able, then they will be better able to move forward. Yeah. Put it two, three things. One basic principle I'd say is that our past explains our emotions, but it doesn't excuse our actions. Our past explains our emotions, and we need that explanation. Why do I feel so angry whenever I see this person? Maybe, you know, that person has done nothing wrong to me, but that person reminds me of someone else who has wronged me terribly. But if I get angry with this person and I yell at them, or I become physically abusive, aggressive, then that is not excusable. So here again, that difference between our emotions, can we change how we feel? That's difficult. It may take a lot of time. But can we change how we act? Yes, we can. We don't necessarily, say for example, with respect to public speaking, some people may have a lot of stage fright. Now that feeling of fear, that feeling of insecurity, that feeling of panic, it may be impossible to get rid of it. But in spite of that feeling, some people can go and they can speak. Maybe they will tend to forget, so they may have to have proper notes. Maybe they have to have an encouraging face in the audience if they start stammering or they start losing their cool. They may need some supports particularly. So, if we get too caught in our emotions and think that my emotion has to be right for my action to be right, it will not work. And that is where I already said, seeing oneself as a spiritual agent, that many times in today's world, people equate the mind and the soul. That means whenever people say, oh, that was such a spiritual gathering, or that was such a spiritual thing, it just made me, the meaning is it made me feel so good. So they often equate the mental with the spiritual. But if you understand that the inner world is a difference between the mind and the soul, and the emotions are experienced by the mind, but beyond that is the soul. And the soul is different. Because the soul is different, so I may have this emotion being experienced, but still I can choose, I can decide, and I can act differently. So we all, in some way or the other, are victimized by our past. We all have, everybody has some terrible things that have happened to them. But we don't have to become victims. We don't have to be victims. So that differentiation between the emotion that we are experiencing and the action that we choose, if that can be understood and that can be done, then it's helpful to get beyond the past. And that's why one of the key things, I have a whole talk on how to get past our past. So I talk about four things basically. Purpose, it's acronym, PAST. So purpose, association, spirituality and time. So basically, to put something behind us, we have to put something ahead of us. I need something worthwhile in my life. And that's why one of the best ways to overcome this whole complex of trauma and victimization is take up some responsibility. See, I'm so wounded, I can't take up any responsibility. No, that is the only way you will heal the wound from the wound. As soon as we have some purpose, and when they take up that purpose, then what happens is that starts helping them to put what is behind. And then they need also association of people who will reinforce their looking ahead, not looking behind. That's why sometimes what happens is we say birds of a feather flock together. But then what happens? Birds of a feather flock together and lock everyone outside. That way, so they just come together and they just say, oh, this is bad, that is bad, that is bad. And people come together and they have a pity party. Life is so terrible, people are so terrible. That is not helpful. So, association, that helps us to look forward. And spirituality is where that helps us to understand that I am beyond my mind. My emotions are wounded, but I am a soul different from this. And also time is required. If there is a wound, it will take time to heal. We generally say, don't lament. And for example, when somebody dies, don't lament. That's what we say. But in the Mahabharata itself, of which the Bhagavad-Gita is a part, it is, and Prabhupada also says that in the Bhagavatam, after the whole war got over, there was a grieving period. And all the Pandavas and the Dhritarashtras grieved the loss of their loved ones. So, grieving is essential for healing. So, time is also required to pass. Okay? But gradually, it's possible to go beyond our past.
So, the first P is purpose.
Purpose.
Yes.
So, that, and that purpose usually has to be, it has to be a voluntarily accepted responsibility.
Right.
So, I may feel, oh, my world has collapsed. I don't want to do anything in my life. No. So, if we have that purpose, then we can move on.
So that purpose has to be an objective that you value more than hanging on to your past hurt.
Yeah, definitely. The purpose is something.
Yeah, how would you describe that purpose?
So what kind of purpose will help us? Yeah, that's why definitely. Either we value that purpose more than the wound from the past, or it could also be that sometimes the fear of the negative can also help us. That means, I just feel wounded, I grieve, but after I grieve, what happens? After I lament, then I start becoming resentful. Now, if I am so miserable, what right does anyone else have to be happy? I become resentful of everyone who is happy, and this was one of my major problems with communism. Maybe I'll talk about liberal and conservative in another question answer. But the point is that in communism, they professed their concern for the poor. All these capitalists, wealthy people, they are exploiting the poor. But you know what activated them more was not concern for the poor, but hatred for the wealthy. So what happens is that sometimes when we keep festering in the negative, or we keep staying in the negative, then that negative becomes our defining identity. So we become resentful of people who are happy. And then, not only resentful, we can become destructive. Either I can destroy my own existence, what is the use of my life? Or I can destroy other people's existence. You know, what right do they have to live? Sometimes, envisioning that, you know, we need to be terrified of how terrible we can become if we stay on this course. And that can also jolt. I can't continue this way. So I might be at this level and it's okay. I'm just lamenting. But if I meet somebody else, you know, chronic complaining, hateful, I don't want to become like this. And from here to there, it might say, I'll never become like this, but it's a journey. It's a journey, it's a slippery slope. So yes, if we can find something which we value in a positive purpose, that's good. But if we feel this is so terrible, that I just can't. I don't feel anything is worthwhile. But then at least we can say that no matter how bad things are, we never lose the power to make them worse.
Ha 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 ha
So they're bad over here, but if I stay on this path, they'll not only stay bad, they'll become worse. So then that can also give us the hope, okay, if I have the power to make them worse, then I also have the power to make them better. I'm not as powerless as I think. So that's why we can say that for coming towards God, there is fear of God and there is love for God. So now love for God is a very good positive motive, but fear of God is also a useful motive for many people. So similarly, fear of what we may become if we continue on that track, on the track of self-pity or negativity, that can be also a motive for change. And also the love for what we can become, what we can contribute, that's also a positive motive. Okay, thank you. Yes, for me.
You talked about galabjamins.
Yeah.
Will there be any?
Well, there can be many in our imagination.
I have a second point. This may be because I was with my relatives this past weekend. It seems like this idea of emotion and dedication is similar to the classic Christian battle of faith and works to some extent.
Okay.
You can see that?
Yeah, faith without works is of no use, they say.
That's, some people say that, yeah.
Yeah.
Well, I think it's in the Bible, but not everybody feels that way. And I was just wondering that, because I have a lot of born-again Christians in my family. And, you know, sometimes devotees say, like, never try to talk to a born-again Christian. But not in terms of, like, trying to get them to understand Krishna consciousness, but to try to help them to see the value of dedication within their own faith. I was curious as to how you might broach that.
Okay. Yeah. So, if somebody is a born again Christian, often the dynamic of emotion dedication, which I talked about, is similar to faith and works. So, how do we help them to appreciate the idea of dedication in their faith? Yes. See, broadly, any relationship has two parts to it, that what the other person is doing for us and what we are doing for the other person. Christianity has historically focused on what Jesus has done for us. That Jesus died to save you. So often the stress in Christianity is on how much God loves us. But because they use, because in their own way of interpreting things, they said that you are washed off of all your sins by Jesus saving grace, Jesus crucifixion. So many Christians feel that there is nothing that we need to do, we are already saved. Or at least there is, of course, an understanding we have to live morally, but that emphasis on how we are to love God or what we need to do to express our love to God, that is inadequately stressed. I would say in our tradition, we often go towards the other extreme.
Yes.
We don't talk much about how much Krishna loves us. Mm-hmm. We focus more on how we are to love Krishna. And how we are to follow the process of sadhana for that. Now, they often consider that sadhana is like man trying to approach God, and they say that is impossible. It's only when God approaches us, then we can connect with Him. So they consider any effortful endeavor to try to connect with God, that as almost arrogant, presumptuous and antithetical to the principle of grace. So that's why the idea that just as Jesus carried a cross, we all are meant to carry a cross. We all also have our crosses to carry, and we need to carry them as gracefully as he carried them. That has been significantly de-emphasized. Now, there are some Christians also, and of course, there are some critics of Christianity who say that within Jesus' own teachings, his stress has always been on living a moral, responsible, devoted life. But when he was killed, that was like a shattering event which could have ended their faith. And then the apostles, based on various events, they reinterpreted that to mean that Jesus died for us. And in this reinterpretation, Paul was one of the primary persons. Paul was blinded on the way to, where was that?
Damascus,
yeah. On the way to Damascus, he was blinded, and then he got his eyes back. So he shifted, or at least that's one way of looking at it, that Paul shifted the focus of Christianity from living like Jesus to accepting Jesus as a savior who died for us. And because of that, the emphasis on living like Jesus has been significantly lost. But we can say that, so this is from our perspective to understand where they are. So if you look at the Bible itself, what Bible in terms of the Gospels? See, the Bible is a big book, and most of it is, a large part of it, the Bible as it is compiled today, is the epistles of Paul to various people. But if you look at the Gospels themselves, which describe how Jesus lived, what he taught. So he is not talking anything about, I have come to save you. Not talking in that mode at all. And you have faith in me. You also have to live morally. He says, after Mary Magdalene is saved, she says that you have to sin no more. So there's definitely the emphasis on living a moral, God-centered life. And we could say that is significantly similar to the principles of sadhana bhakti. It's not exactly, it may not have exactly prescribed a sadhana, but at least sattva-guni living based on some moral principles, that's definitely there. And Jesus would also fast, and he would pray, and at the 40 days, that whole period when he was tempted by Satan in various ways. Now you could very well say that's sadhana. That's sadhana. He is fasting, he is praying, he is meditating, he is resisting temptation. So that's disciplined spiritual practice. So it's not just works in the mundane sense of works. It is actually a striving to go closer to God. So so that is also compatible with their teachings, provided we don't make that Jesus having died for us as the sole point of Christianity, which unfortunately has become for many people. Mm-hmm. And maybe Calvinism was the most extreme example of that, where that was one version of Protestantism which said that who is going to be saved is already destined. And predestination was made a central theme. And it was afterwards used very conveniently that all those who accept Calvinism, they are destined to be saved. And those who don't accept it, they are lost. So
Calvin had problems with that himself. He was very insecure. He always wondered, am I one of the saved?
Really?
Yeah,
so Calvin himself wondered like that, yeah. So I think there's a few thoughts.
Yes,
that makes sense.
Just
thank you.
One small thing. We can keep the questions going, but I'll just serve the prasad. We can keep the questions going. I don't want to stop.
How do I keep the answers going if I am eating? Okay, now I'll take later. Here with you. Well, the biggest plate for me. Oh, really? Hey, that's beautiful.
Oh, that's nice.
Aww. Yeah.
Oh,
and this is a smile? That's cute. Yeah.
So, wanted to ask, like,
the presentation looked like a technical presentation of anartha and nivritti kind of presentation. So we see some kind of devotees like just with their faith and dedication to what they have received from their spiritual master, they kind of like not caring much, like they're just super focused and they kind of keep going kind of thing. But on the other hand, like personally I see, okay, then if you're not that sincere or that dedicated, then have to take so much support of introspection and like speaking to people and taking help and like somehow or other like kind of push through the phase. So how much
okay.
introspection is like a is like kind of a, an alternate for lacking some dedication? Because okay with introspection I kind of understand and try to become dedicated, but how much it is like sustainable or
okay.
right?
Okay, good question. Some people just by their faith in Guru and Krishna just move on and they deal with whatever issues life sends their way. But some of us may need to do a lot of introspection and to somehow come to a some workable understanding and move on. So how much introspection is valid and how much to do? Yeah, a tough question. I know one senior Srila Prabhupada disciple, very devoted, very dedicated. He said, I have 3 cupboards filled with journals that I have written. And I have written in my will that when I die, along with my body, all these journals should also be burned. So I asked why. So he says, there's a lot of anger in the journals. So I process that anger by writing about it. But the people I have written about, I don't want them to read it. So he spends a lot of time, I mean a good amount of time journaling. And he says, I've been doing it for many, many years. So then I asked him, is there any Shastric precedent of our acharyas doing any journaling? So as there is Prabhupada's journal in the sense that what he wrote on Jaladutta when he was traveling. But that's more like a report or a record rather than a journal. It's not his emotion so much. It's more a report of events. So his point was that we live in an age which is much more disturbed than in the past. And the characteristics of Kali Yuga is upadrutaha. Upadrutaha, disturbed. In fact, you say the word yah comes before that. Yah is certainly. So even if the other things are manda bhag, what is the verse? Praya and alpayu sabhya, kalavasmin yugejana, manda sumanda matayo, manda bhagyaya upadrutaha. So even if the other things are not there, even somebody is not unfortunate, even somebody is not less intelligent, somebody is not misdirected, they are certainly disturbed. That is the idea. So being disturbed, being mentally agitated, that is largely a very strong characteristic of Kali Yuga. And to some extent, in the last maybe 50 years or last 20, 30 years also. See, many of the structures that gave stability to people's lives have become disrupted. Religion was one structure, family was one structure, maybe a predicted life chart in terms of job or career. Most people would live in their small villages or their towns, they would live there and they would die there. So you could say, oh, there was no excitement in their lives. Okay, maybe that's one way of looking, but there was much more structure, there was peace. Now, many of the structures that bring stability to our lives, they have been disrupted. And therefore, we are much more agitated. So we need, whatever we need to do, we need to do. And is it that those devotees who have simple faith in Krishna and Guru, they are necessarily more advanced or more, their life is simpler? Yeah, we can say that life is simpler, but then, and they can be also inspiration for us about the simplicity and the potency of bhakti. But I think those who do introspection, they are also often able to present bhakti in a more relatable way with others, to others. So this can also become an approach to connect with people. So for most people who are having some trouble, just chant Hare Krishna and be happy. That is not going to help them. And those who say this will simply alienate others. So again, I would say that with our mind or without our mind. So some people, these things don't matter for them. And that's okay. If that's the way they can best practice, that's wonderful. If that's not the way they can practice, then then need to be also provided a way. So basically you could say the general principle is we all need we need to find a way of practicing bhakti that works for our mind and our heart. Okay.
And also this anarthas and swabhava, it, as you said, like there seems to be in a practical thing, there seems to be a lot of gray. Like when
okay.
we start following a swabhava, sometimes the anarthas kind of like can comfortably come in also. So,
okay.
and sincerity is required to know the difference, okay, how much to engage with the swabhava. So, what is the best way to judge that?
Okay. So if we are doing according to the swabhava also anarthas can come in, yeah, that's easily possible, but I wouldn't put it that way, it's that simply. So like some people say that, okay, if I can sing nicely, I can speak nicely, but if I do that, I'll become proud. But that is an oversimplified understanding of thinking, of the situation, because you know, to say that I will become proud, it presumes that I am not proud right now, isn't it? So, and you say to say that I will become proud can also be a proud statement, because I am saying I am not proud right now, isn't it? So, what is quite likely is that it's not that I don't have pride, but I don't have anything to be proud about right now. Isn't it? So, but that doesn't mean it's like if I am fasting because it's Ekadashi, I am renounced. But if I am fasting because I have no food to eat, that's not renunciation, isn't it? So, just because I have nothing to be proud of, and so I am not proud. That doesn't necessarily mean I am humble. So that doesn't mean I have to have something to be proud of and not be proud. It's not like that. It's the point is that we, it's not necessary that acting according to our swabhava alone will create the anartha. We could say that acting according to our swabhava may create a situation which makes the anarthas manifesting easier. But then that's the time when I select. Okay, we might go in that direction, but is it that anartha that is it that the swabhava, acting out of swabhava caused it? No, it is already there. Acting out of swabhava manifested it, and then how do I deal with it? So, it's often that after we express, after we do what we are meant to do, that's only actually we get to choose something higher. So, I asked once Radhanath Maharaj this question that the child in the womb, he prays very sincerely to the Lord and he says, my dear Lord, this world is such an illusory place, I don't want to go there, of course I will forget you. And then he goes out and he forgets. So, is the Lord not answering the prayer? What's happening? So, Maharaj said, no, the Lord always answers our prayers, but the point is, devotion practiced under duress, under distress, that is not fully mature devotion, because you are practicing that devotion because of the distress. So, then the Lord gives us the opportunity that when there is no distress, are you ready to practice devotion? So, if okay, let's give another example. So, if a boy wants to marry a girl, he says, please marry me. Why? Because nobody else wants to marry me. And now, will that give, that's not a very attractive proposal for the girl, from the girl's perspective. So, that means that, you know, okay, they think you are my last option, nothing else is working, so at least you become my last option. So, God is ready to become our last option also, but that doesn't really show our devotion so much. It's when we have other options but we choose God. That is when our serious devotion is shown. So then we act according to our swabhava and we become something in the world. And then we reject the world for Krishna. That is where our seriousness is shown. Now sometimes somebody might not become someone in the world also after doing the swabhava, that's fine. But I don't think it's the acting according to swabhava that causes the anartha. It might cause the opportunity for the anartha to manifest. Okay. Thank you. Yes, Prabhu.
Just one small question. So in the third quadrant, where you have no emotions but dedication.
Yeah.
So isn't our goal to become emotional? Because even when Prabhupada was watching Radha, Parishishwara, Nandanishwara, like tears were flowing from his eyes like arrows. So isn't our goal, so how does a person who's not emotional become emotional? Or does it automatically happen through the process of devotion?
Okay. So isn't our purpose to actually become emotional also, not just dedicated, filled with emotions for Krishna? Yes, but at the same time, even if somebody is the uttama also comes down to the level of madhyama for functioning in the world. If somebody is filled with ecstasy for Krishna, then they cannot really see, oh, this person is not Krishna conscious. They will see everybody as devotees only. So they have to come down to the level of a madhyama. So even those who are like Prabhupada was, we saw those emotions like that at times. Sometimes he went into trances, but not most of the time he was with us. He was very deeply Krishna conscious, but he was not always like lost in emotions. So if you have to function in the world, then some amount of regulation of the emotions is required. And that is my understanding at least is that the activation of the emotions of the soul, it's different from the activation of emotions at the level of the mind. So like even if you see some devotees, some disciples of Srila Prabhupada or sannyasis, gurus, very dedicated now, but you see they have their own natures. Some of them are really very analytical, sharp, and they're dedicated, but they don't show so much emotions. And some others show a lot of emotions. Now, is it that one is more advanced than the other is advanced? I don't know. So how much the soul's emotions will be activated while we are in this body? I think that is variable. For some people it might become very much activated, for some people it might not be become that much activated. Or it could be that is activated but they chose not to express that. We don't know. So yes, we want to become emotional also in our relationship with Krishna. We want to have emotions, not become emotional. Have emotions in our relationship with Krishna. But that is not the only parameter of spiritual advancement. In the Bhakti Rasamrita Sindhu, there is the Ashtasatvika Vikara described. Hair standing on end, tears coming out. But after that, Rupa Goswami describes a list of symptoms of pure devotees, which are, these are non-imitable. Avyartha kalatvam. Just don't waste any time at all. Namagane sadaruchi. That constantly wanting to glorify the holy names of Krishna. Samutkanta. Eagerness to hear about Krishna. So, and virakti. Detachment from the world. So, those, the tears, I think I heard this is attributed to Bhakti Sanskrit Thakur. I have not seen the quote. Bhakti Sanskrit Thakur says, what is the price of tears? He said it is charana. Why 25 paise? That is the price of getting some onions. Put some onions near your eyes, tears will come. Very advanced in deceiving, in pretending. Yeah. Yes, Prabhu.
I was very intrigued when you spoke about sometimes we hide something, we care about it so much, we hide it so carefully, then we can't find it.
Yeah.
And it made me happy because I've been experiencing sometimes I'm thinking, where is my love for Krishna? You know, I've been practicing so many years, but I can't, you know, connect with that. You know, ecstasy, love, you know, like, it was very intriguing, this example, because I've done that many times. I'll say, okay, now I really don't want to lose this, so I'm going to put it, I'm going to hide it really well, and then when I want to get it, it's like, where did I put that? And I'm lost completely. I can really relate to that.
Yeah.
It's a nice idea to think I've done that with my love of Krishna.
Yeah, that's true.
I can't find it.
Yeah, it's not lost because it is, because it's not there, but it's deep inside. Yeah, that's true. But we also need sometimes when we also need sometimes when we are actually expressing it directly or connecting with Krishna. So while hearing about other things like Janmashtami or the festival times, we need to hear about Krishna directly also, so that that part is also nourished. Yeah, thank you. Yes, Prabhu. Thank you, Hare Krishna. That's a good reflection. Yeah.
So, on the topic of coming over the trauma, traumatic situation, we have the past economy. So, first one is the purpose. And so, someone close to me is going through that process. So, it is up to him or her to find their purpose. So, is there something like as a friend or someone who really cares about them? Association or something practical we can do for them to be able to find that purpose, or that association that we can do, or is it just the prayers?
Yeah, if somebody is going through trauma and is stuck over there, can we help them? How can we help them find a purpose? Yeah, generally one of the best ways I have found is small, simple steps. I call it SSS. Just do something small. Start. To find out a purpose in life, it can be very difficult. What do I want to do with my life? But okay, I'm in this situation. See, in any situation in our life, if we just a little reflective, we can think about maybe three things that I'm doing which are making things worse. And they are stoppable if I try. Some things are making things worse, some habits are very difficult to give up. Okay, maybe three things which I can do which can make things better. And again, very simple things. So, like some people fall sick and then they become so rude and disagreeable and irritated and irritating that their caregiver, they are sick and their caregivers become sick of them. Isn't it? So I can just decide that, you know, I'll be polite with people. And I can't be always polite, I get irritated. Okay, for the next 1 hour, I will not snap at anyone. Can I do that? Yeah, I think for 1 hour I can do that. And then you don't see a frown on the people around you, you see them smiling, you feel a little better. Then take one more step. So often, it is, everybody has a conscience. Their conscience is not always right, but they have to begin with their conscience. That means, okay, what is a good thing which I can do in this situation? Sometimes you have to just let them speak, let them, you know, you just throw, what is that principle? Okay, it's like sometimes not helping people is the best way of helping them. That means, say a child is trying to learn to walk and a child is falling. If the mother immediately comes and catches, okay, I'll hold you and walk always. Sometimes the mother has to let the child fall and the child rises again. So similarly, when somebody comes up with a problem, instead of, oh, my life is so terrible, this is so bad, okay, then turn the question around and ask them only, what do you think you can do about this? I can't do anything. But if someone else were in the situation, what would you tell them to do? Basically, get them to think. and what can you, and sometimes people say, I can't do anything. But if you ask them at the right time, instead of telling them, oh, stop doing this, what can you do about this? And see, the super soul ultimately is a giver of wisdom. But somehow, we trust the super soul who is in our hearts more than the super soul in someone else's heart. That means if the same idea comes from someone else, hey, it's your idea, maybe I can't do it. The same idea comes from within me, hey, it's my idea, I'll do it. So, sometimes turning it around and just asking them, what do you think you could do? I said, further turn the question around, and if somebody else were in this situation, what would you tell them? What would you suggest to them? So, get them thinking, the small steps. Sometimes we need to push people also, that you have to push them, you know, come on, let's, somebody just wants to stay stuck at their homes, lost in loneliness, lost in self-pity, come on, let's go out. Say, no, come on. So, we may have to see what we can do, but just, the principle is small, simple steps, which either they want to take or we get them to take, and then gradually things will improve. One way it can help is also, if we can get them to do something for someone else. That means, you know, say somebody is starving and you just go and give them some food, and then they smile and they thank. Sometimes what happens when terrible things happen in our life, we start feeling, is anything worthwhile? There are many losses we can have in our life, but the most disempowering loss is the loss of meaning and value. If I start feeling life itself has no meaning, life has no value, nothing will make any difference. Then if they can see that things can, yeah, this person was starving, I gave them some food. Do something for someone, and that reaffirms that my existence has some value. I can do something of value, and that can trigger that positive reaction for them, positive transformation for them. Okay, thank you. Any comments? Yeah.
Like in this answer you were giving, this example of mother sometimes like have to let the child like kind of fall and then kind of get up. So, as personally, while dealing with ourselves, sometimes we see, oh, we commit some mistakes and we kind of then realize, oh, this is a mistake, so and then we rectify. So, should we see this as anarthanivriti, or should we see this as lack of sincerity, or we should see, oh, Krishna somehow that helped me kind of see this as a mistake and then kind of help me, is helping me to overcome. It looks like is it a combination of all? How do we process this? Because there guilt also are there. If it is not processed properly, then either it is guilt or it is like, it's okay, I can, it's not a problem, I can keep doing something.
Yeah, it's a tough question. So basically, if we have committed some mistake, then is it just a part of the learning curve, or is it that it's we made a mistake and we should feel guilty and we should overcome it, or is it that, you know, Krishna intervened and we would have done worse, but Krishna has helped us to recover? So how do we see our own lapses? At least my understanding of this is, the most important thing in bhakti is to stay encouraged. No matter how many mistakes we have committed, if we are encouraged, then there is some chance of improving. Yes. If we are feeling so discouraged that we just lose hope, then there is no chance of changing. So then, if I committed a mistake and I overcame it, then which is the most encouraging interpretation of that for me? We can interpret in different way. Actually, I didn't have done it last time also. I was stupid. So instead of feeling satisfied that I did the right thing now, I feel dissatisfied that why did I do the wrong at the previous time. Well, if that inspires us to become more cautious, that's good. But if that makes us feel, start loathing ourselves for whatever, then that's unhealthy. So basically, look at the result of any choice. And if thinking that, oh, Krishna has helped me, encourages me, then that's good. If sometimes it also happens that I'm not able to change something, then what do? Then some anarthas for some people may just take a very long time to change. They need to work on it, but whenever we are working on anything also, we need some sense of progress and success. But some anarthas are like immobile mountains, you know, that thing seems to be moving. So, what did you say?
I said, can you tell I'm laughing a little too hard?
Can you tell her?
I'm laughing a little too hard.
Yeah, I think we all are. So, if some arthas seem like an immovable mountain, then maybe we have to stop using that anartha as the parameter for our spiritual advancement. Maybe this
attractive statement. Tell me more.
That sounds
attractive
statement. Yeah. So now, for example, anger. Now we may say that as we practice bhakti, we our anarthas go down, so anger also goes down. Now, but some people, their anger just stays as it is. Now, if they rate their spiritual advancement based on their capacity to control anger, now they may just feel I'm just stagnating. But if they're growing in other aspects of their life, they're becoming more and more committed, they're doing more and more services, and that means, okay, this particular part is, it may take a lot of time for me to get over this. So I want to get over this, but if I measure my spiritual advancement solely based on that, then I'll be discouraged. So we need to be encouraged enough, okay, this battle I'm not able to win, and let me I'm fighting other battles, I can win those battles, let me win those battles. So maybe as we grow in our spiritual life, then that anartha would be more winnable for us. We would be in a more winnable situation. So we have to basically adopt an attitude toward a situation that is encouraging. Not encouraging in the sense of pampering that everything is all right, nothing is wrong, but encouraging in the sense that it gives us enough impetus to try to make a change. So guilt in that sense is again, Fallina Parijayate, where the guilt works. So, I have a whole class on this, but basically you could say that if the soul is here, the wrongdoing is here, Krishna is here. So, now the guilt should come here, stop us from doing the wrongdoing. But sometimes guilt comes here. That means, oh, I am so fallen, how can I practice bhakti? Or, even after practicing bhakti, I am staying so fallen, so what is the use of practicing bhakti? Both ways. So, if the guilt is coming over here between me and Krishna, then we can say even that guilt is actually pseudo-guilt. It is Maya coming in the form of a guilt. So, that is unhealthy. Let me put it aside and move on. So, the class I have, any other questions are there, or I'll just elaborate with this and we'll end it. Any other questions or comments? Okay, so I'll just elaborate this. I have this, the classes, the four categories of people. Those people who have weak conscience and weak willpower. They are terrible and they don't even notice they're terrible. They are terrible and they are happily terrible.
Yeah, ignorance is bliss.
Sorry?
They
Yeah, that's true. Ignorance is bliss, but not for the not for those who are not ignorant. You know. So, the second is you have weak weak conscience, weak willpower. Strong conscience, weak willpower. These are the people who are tormented. Tormented. Why did I do that? Why did I do that? Why did I do that? Then you can have strong willpower and weak conscience. They are the people who are dangerous. Dangerous. You know, because they have strong willpower, they can do a lot. But because their conscience is weak, if they get misled, then they can do horrible things and they will not feel bad also about it. So, if people who are like dictators, tyrants, somebody like Hitler, he had strong willpower to raise, to galvanize the whole country and to envision an invasion of the whole world. But completely, you could say, heartless, weak conscience, that's dangerous. And then there is strong conscience and strong willpower. That is the stage of purified state. So, when we are in this stage, to come to your question, that when we are in the stage of strong conscience and weak willpower, there are two ways to get out of it, to get out of the torment. One is by strengthening our willpower, and the other is by weakening our conscience. So, now,
which one sees you?
See, it's always easier to make people stupider than smarter. Same applies to us also. So, yeah, weakening our conscience is usually easier, and that is not recommended. And that's why now we have moral relativism, which is quite prominent. Because many people say, I don't no need to change myself. This is the way I am, and I want to stay where. And you, if you think this is wrong, that's your problem, not my problem. So we don't want moral relativism. But the point is, when we are in that torment, we want to strengthen our willpower, but that will take time. So if we have a strong conscience, then sometimes we don't want to weaken the conscience, but we need to some extent, numb the conscience. It's like numb means, say, if I have a disease and I have pain, the solution is that I take the curative medicine, cure the disease, and then I will become free from the pain and become free from the disease, both. So that's like moving to the healthy state. So I strengthen my willpower and then I overcome that. But when this pain is very strong, when the disease is very long, very deep rooted, then sometimes the curative medicine may not work immediately. Then a painkiller is required. So, that means we need to be taking the medicine, we need to be transforming ourselves, working to transform ourselves. But while we are working to transform ourselves, we also need to accept ourselves. So, accepting ourselves is like a painkiller. Accepting ourselves should not close the door to self-transformation. So, self-acceptance is, if somebody is only self-accepting, oh, the way you are perfect. Well, that is, if somebody says that, that's a very narcissistic statement. You know, nobody is perfect. Who can say they are perfect? But, so that is like taking only a painkiller and not even thinking I need a medicine. So that is like completely weakening our conscience, so that we will stay comfortable where we are. But while we are there and we are working to strengthen our willpower, but we need to live at that time. So how do we live? So we need to some extent numb our conscience or numb the pain or make the pain of coming from that conscience tolerable. That's where the self-acceptance comes into the picture. So self-acceptance is more like a painkiller, you could say. Self-acceptance is a painkiller. Self-transformation is the curative medicine. So we want both. Make sense?
No problem. I struggle forever. about making the distinction between self-acceptance and complacency. Because I feel like this can be a slippery slope.
Okay. What is the
instant connection to that? Like in the acharyas or in the the traditional text, we don't get these kind of details. But I think, I see like the more Kali Yuga is progressing and devotees are trying to, even in Prabhupada's disciples' generation, their discussion, their classes, it's all like seems to be like things are very simple. But as we start practicing, it seems like there are so many details. So I don't know if in that generation, on a personal basis, they dealt with all these details.
Yeah.
Or but when I see the like the generation where I'm hearing from, there seems to be a lot of details in that practice while going through Anathanavati. It is because the movement is maturing and we are seeing more and more things. Our Kali Yuga is posing more and more challenges. Our people are becoming like weak in their willpower and that's what is. So how do we see this?
They're not same question, they're very different, but I appreciate what you're saying. Let me answer the question first. So, how do we differentiate between self-acceptance and complacency? Self-acceptance can easily become a slippery slope toward complacency.
Yeah.
So, how do we avoid that? While we're accepting ourselves, we don't become complacent. Is that the question?
Yeah.
Okay. So basically, there should always be something we are working on to change ourselves.
Mm-hmm.
So when I'm talking about self-acceptance, it's not that everything about me is all right.
Mm-hmm.
There are things which need to be fixed.
Mm-hmm.
What is that? There is a famous book called I Am Okay, You Are Okay.
Mm-hmm.
So Prabhupada said that's not right.
Mm-hmm.
No, Prabhupada said what is it? I am okay, you are not okay. Because we are practicing bhakti or not. But we could put it another way. We are all sadhakas. I am not okay, you are not okay. I am not okay, you are not okay, and that's okay. So now okay in the sense that we all can only fight. We can't fight infinite battles. We have to choose our battles. So, if we have chosen a particular battle and we are fighting it diligently, then it's not complacency. But if we just don't need to fight any battle at all, and say for example, some Christians say that, okay, Jesus has saved me, I don't need to do any moral striving at all, then that is definitely a problem. So, it will become complacency if we are not fighting any battle. But we may choose our battles. In fact, I write this Gita daily articles every day. So one article I am just writing in the next few days is, when we limit our challenges, we can challenge our limits. When we limit our challenges, I cannot fight these 10 battles I can't fight. But I have to fight one battle. In this, I am limited this much. I can push this limit. So when we limit our challenges, we can challenge our limits. But if we are limiting our challenges and I'm not challenging any limit, that's when we are becoming complacent. But if we are not limiting our challenges also, then it's basically we are overestimating our capacities, and then soon we'll come down with a rude shock, and then we become so discouraged that we will go to the other extreme of not again challenging any limits at all. Just passive. Okay.
Somebody gave me like a really, you remind me of an analogy that he gave me. Let's say if somebody's whole mouth is bad, all his teeth are bad, if you go to the dentist and you have him, you know, extract, honk out every one all in the one visit, you know.
Oh, oh God.
No, you extract a few at a time, you know. Not every, you know, a few visits, you spread it out, you know.
Yeah, it's a very good example. Some devotee preachers are like that. I want to cure you of all your dental problems in one visit. And I'll do it without anesthesia.
One punch. Yeah, okay. The last question. So is it that Kali Yuga is getting more degraded, or is it that we are becoming more introspective and all this is coming up? One thing is that our Acharya's writings, we have only a very limited corpus available to us. And in the past, most transmission of spiritual knowledge for the purpose of practice was done through the oral tradition. The written tradition, books were not easy to write, not to replicate before the printing press came up. So there, books were written by scholars for scholars. So, if you see Vishwanatha Chakravarti Thakur's commentary, for example, there is very little practical instruction, like Prabhupada says, give up sense gratification, thing like that. Very little of that you will find in his books, because he is not writing for general people. So there are local sadhus who would, in each village or each town, they would just speak those practical instructions. The written tradition was primarily for scholars. For scholars by scholars. So that's why the practical application, that is not there in the books. Now Prabhupada integrated some amount of practical application in his books, but we cannot say that that alone is exhaustive. It has to be, so a lot of practical things which are passed in the oral tradition, they are not available to us now, but we can see that in our lives. The same point, we could put it another way. See, we do emphasize a lot on reading books, but if you look at our own spiritual lives, we learn a lot more by hearing than by reading. Some devotees may be very scholarly and they read and they relish, but most of us learn a lot more by hearing than by reading. And this is not to de-emphasize the importance of reading books, but it's just to express a lived reality for us. That's because you cannot change the tradition. The oral tradition is what is, you could say, more of a living tradition. And it's important that we discuss and we learn and we share. And every age has its characteristics. So if you see in the later part of Chaitanya Charitamrita, there are a lot of verses which say about how a devotee is a kavi. A devotee is a poet, and it's praise how Rupa Goswami has composed such beautiful poetry. So now, was Prabhupada the poet? You could say, yeah, he was. He wrote Gitar Gan, he wrote his Bhagavad. What is that? He wrote his Markandeya Bhagavatam and few other like that. But Prabhupada is not a poet as extensive as, say, Narottam Das Thakur or Bhaktivinoda Thakur. We don't see many bhajans written by Bhaktivinoda Thakur. So the point here is that, at that time in Bengal, Kavya and Natya were very prominent. And that's why our Acharyas used those existing cultural forms to present Bhakti. And they demonstrated how devotees are also expert in this.
Kavya and Natya.
Natya is drama or play.
Natya is drama.
Drama, yeah.
Oh, drama.
Drama, yeah.
Oh, okay.
And Kavya is poetry. Bhakti wisdom. Will write award poetry, or how many can actually devotee have to write poetry? Yes, they can write for self-expression. But is poetry going to be a major means for outreach in today's world? Not necessarily. So the adaptation of bhakti to of bhakti outreach or bhakti application to existing cultural forms, that is integral to our tradition. Like if you see. Now, all these are more positive examples, not negative examples, but I wouldn't call it negative. Introspection, is it negative? Not necessarily. You see that, have you heard of the Chitra Kavitavani? Chitra Kavitavani is is chitra is pictures, kavita is poetry, vani is sound. So these are artistic forms of poetry which Rupa Goswami has composed. So for example, there is one verse which is just filled with two letters describing Govardhan Lila, two syllables. Dhare dhara 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 rudi dhira dhara dhadi rodham radha dhuram dharam. Now two syllables for a whole verse. There's one verse, one syllable. Nīnun nānonanam nūnam nānun no nānununi nānau nānānano nūnum nēnun nānānanonane. It's just na and its variants. So describing how Brahma with tear-filled eyes is offering prayers to Krishna after he has been exposed. Sorry?
It's a different language,
you know. Chinese. Chinese. Baby.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
I was at one devotee's house and we memorized this verse. Then that Mataji told me, oh, now whenever I don't want to talk with my husband, I'll recite this verse. So now, the point I am making is, for him to write that kind of verse, it must have required hours and hours, days and weeks. It's not that it just came spontaneously. Yes. But that kind of Chitra Kavita Vani was prevalent over there.
So like
there is
method of preaching or
it's a method of cultural expression to connect with the contemporary world. In fact, at that time there is a book, I forget the name of the book. It's not a very book like 25 pages or something. You read it front to back, it is Ramayana. If you read back to front, it is Mahabharata. So it's a palindrome, but it's not one word, it's a book length palindrome. So now it requires effort to write. So Sanskrit was so refined and Sanskrit artistry was so evolved. Our acharyas also participate in that. But it's not that we have to do that. We can do that. The principle we can adapt, that whatever are the existing cultural forms of thinking, of expressing, of analyzing, for acharyas, we have to express bhakti in those cultural forms. So thank you very much. Shri Prabhupada ki. Gaur Bhakta Vrindaki Tai Gaur Premanande. Oh.